Here is every cosmetic pigment explained in 12 minutes. These are also used in paints and lots of other applications. I'm Michelle, I'm a chemistry PhD and cosmetic chemist. When I wrote my book, The Science of Beauty, I got super deep into pigment science. I read multiple textbooks, and there was already too much in my book, so here it is. The most standard kind of pigment are absorption pigments. These are used for matte cream colours. Absorption pigments work by absorbing some colours of light and the rest bounce off into your eye to give you the colour that you see. If you have a red lipstick, for example, we have white light coming in. White light contains all of the colours. It hits the pigment, which absorbs mostly green and blue light. That means that the light that bounces back into your eye will have mostly the complementary colour, which is opposite green in the colour wheel. That's red, so that's what we see. It's kind of ironic, the red lipstick looks red because it is rejecting red light the hardest. There are two main categories of these pigments, organic and inorganic. Organic pigments are carbon-based, and if you look at their structures, you'll see lots of rings and lots of double bonds. In chemistry, we call this conjugated, and it means that the electrons can absorb different colours of light. Chemical sunscreens also have these sorts of structures to absorb UV. Inorganic pigments are metal-based, they're usually based on transition metals, which are sitting in that sort of ditch in the middle of the periodic table. Organic pigments are usually brighter colours than inorganic pigments, but they are less stable, which means they can break down in light over time and go dull. Inorganic pigments are usually duller colours to begin with, but they are less likely to change over time. Here are some fun pigment facts, there are more in my book. Depending on which country you're in, pigments have different names. In the US, organic pigments are listed as colour number, like red 7 or yellow 5. Inorganic pigments are listed by their chemical name, like manganese violet. In the EU, all of these have colour index names, which is CI followed by 5 digits. This has led to a whole bunch of myths, like the idea that black 2, which is carbon black, is banned in the EU but is still allowed in the US, and that's because the EU has safer cosmetics. No, it just goes by a different name there. It is CI77266. It's like James Bond and 007, two names for the same dude. Sometimes you'll see the word lake, and that means that the colour was originally soluble, which means it wouldn't have a lot of opacity or coverage like watercolour paint. Pigments need to be in tiny, insoluble, solid particles to show up more strongly on skin or nails or whatever else, sort of like acrylic paint. So to solve this problem, the soluble substance gets combined with something else and that turns it into a solid lake. Sometimes it gets adsorbed or stuck onto aluminium-based particles. Sometimes they get reactive with metal ions like calcium or barium. Most organic pigments used in products are synthetic, which means that their structures don't exist in nature. One big exception is carmine, a natural organic red pigment which is made from beetles. Inorganic pigments are used in mineral makeup because they're considered more natural. They are found in nature, but most of the time in makeup, inorganic pigments are also made synthetically. That's because the natural mine stuff is often contaminated with toxic heavy metals, which you don't want, and the quality is usually more consistent if it's made in a lab. Iron oxides are inorganic and they're used to get skin tones in almost all foundations. There's red, yellow, and black. Natural iron oxides are actually banned in cosmetics in the US because of this heavy metal contamination problem. The other big category of pigments are interference pigments, and these create colour in a different way. Instead of absorbing part of the light, they essentially bounce it funny and you get lots of really cool effects. For example, on my nails, the grey comes from absorption pigments, but the blue sparkle on top is an interference pigment. This is starting to get into physics, which I am not that great at, so my old day job boss, Dr Alex Argyros, very kindly looked over this. His specialty is actually optics, so if any of this is wrong, it is definitely my fault. The simplest type of interference pigments are synthetic pearl pigments, which is the shimmer in most of our shimmer products. These were invented in the 1960s and they're made of very flat particles, usually mica or synthetic mica, coated in a thin layer of a metal oxide, usually titanium dioxide. When light comes in, some of it bounces off the top surface, but some of it bounces off the lower surface. This means that the two can be out of sync and these add together to give the colour that you see. You might remember that light is a wave. If you have two waves that are perfectly in sync, they'll reinforce each other so the colour gets stronger. If you have two waves that are perfectly out of sync, they'll cancel out, and if they're somewhere in between, they'll be slightly strengthened or weakened. This is called constructive and destructive interference. Different colours have different wavelengths, so depending on how far apart these two surfaces are, how thick that outside layer is, you end up with different colours being strengthened or cancel out, so you get different shimmer colours. Now, some of you might be wondering, these are the synthetic pearl pigments, what about the natural ones? Well, the first pearl pigment was natural, it's called natural fish silver, and it's made from fish. Fish scales have really flat guanine crystals in a complex layered structure, which means there are lots of different constructive and destructive interferences. You get lots of different colours, so this looks silvery with a subtle iridescent rainbow effect. The problem with this is that it is ridiculously expensive. You need more than 4 tons of fish to get 1 kilo of pigment. Plus, it's also really fragile, so it just doesn't get used much. Sometimes if you see a really bright metallic shimmer, it's actually even more basic than this. These are metallic pigments, which are literally ground up little flakes of metal, so aluminium, bronze, and copper. Multichrome pigments are also called color shift or chameleon pigments. Back to this diagram with our pearl pigment particle. If our eye moves over here, then the light would be coming in at a different angle. The bottom wave would be traveling for longer before coming back out, so it's like the film is effectively thicker. The waves would be out of sync by a different amount, which means a different color. This means that with pearl pigments, the color changes depending on the viewing angle, but the change isn't that big, so it is just a subtle change. If we want a bigger change in color, we need the light to be more out of sync. We need the light to travel for much longer before coming out. And to get this to happen, the answer is mirrors. So in the middle of a multichrome pigment, we have a piece of aluminium that acts as a mirror, and we have a layer of translucent chromium on the outside that acts as a two-way mirror. The light bounces back and forth inside the middle layer before it comes out and hits your eye, so when you change the viewing angle by a little bit, the color changes a lot. Holographic pigments are the silvery glitter sort of pigments that give a really cool rainbow effect. The most famous one is called Spectraflair, and its particles are really tiny zigzags. The inside is really shiny mirror-like aluminium, and the outside is a clear glassy layer, and this forms what's called a diffraction grating. When light comes in and hits it, each of the ridges in the little zigzag reflects some of the light, and all these reflections will interfere with each other. This is like the synthetic pearl pigments, but instead of reflecting off different layers, we're reflecting off the different ridges. How the interference works out depends on the angle. Different colors will be in sync or out of sync, so overall we end up with different colors at different angles. We get a rainbow. This is the same as what's happening when you see a rainbow on the back of a CD, assuming we all still know what a CD is. There are two main types of adjusting pigment in makeup. These are the ones that change color after you put them on. They often say things like it adjusts to your skin pH or it creates a custom color, but it doesn't really. The color changing effect is cool, but these products end up the same color on everyone. It's not like magically sensing what color your skin is and creating the perfect color for you like some microscopic fairy godmother. Sorry to break it to you, but we aren't getting microscopic fairy godmothers for like $20. The first type you get in lipsticks and blushes. They start off colorless and end up pink. Some products will use other colors in the base, like green, and that just makes the color change a bit more dramatic. The green is light enough that it gets drowned out by the pink. The ingredients in these are usually red 27 and red 21, and these just work because of water. The structure of these dyes can change depending on the conditions. In chemistry, we call this a dynamic equilibrium. When there's no water or the pH is very low, then they're in the colorless form, but when you do have water and the pH is higher, they end up in the pink form. Inside the product you don't have water, so it starts off colourless, but when you put it on, there is lots of water. There's water evaporating from your skin all the time, and obviously your lips are really wet, so it goes pink. Now I said that pH can also change the colour, but the pH where these stop being pink, it's super low. Red 27 is only colourless below pH 2.5, red 21 needs to be below pH 0. Your skin is about pH 5, saliva is about 7, chemical exfoliants only go down to about pH 3.5. So practically speaking, it's just going to be pink when you've had it on your skin for more than a few minutes. There's only really two of these dyes, which is why all these products end up as the same sort of pink color and you never see like blue. Now the second type of adjusting pigments are usually in skin color products. The color shows up when you rub the product into your skin, and these just have regular pigments in them, which are usually iron oxides. The difference is these are encapsulated. Basically, they are stored inside little white popping boba. When you rub them, the shells burst and the color comes out. With both of these types of products, they're usually formulated to be quite sheer, so I guess you do end up with like a personalized color, which is the product plus your underlying skin color, but it is just as custom as any other sheer product. Thermochromic pigments change color with temperature. They're in mood rings, temperature stickers, and in nail polishes. There are two main types. The first type has cholesterol crystals inside little capsules. The crystals are arranged in layers and the distance between the layers change depending on temperature. So it's a lot like those pearl interference pigments. You get different colors with different distances. That is the more common type. The other type are called leuco dyes, and these work a lot like the pH adjusting pigments. There are two forms of the molecule that are different colours, and the one that you get depends on the conditions. With these, instead of having water, they change colour with a solvent that melts near body temperature. The dye and the solvent are inside little capsules, and when the solvent is solid, it's frozen, it can't interact with the dye. When the solvent gets warmer, it melts, so it interacts with the dye, and it turns it into the other colour. UV colour change pigments are also called photochromic pigments, and again, there are two versions of the molecule. There's the normal version, which is what it prefers to be without UV. This has a bond that's really easily broken by UV, and when that breaks, it turns into the second version, which is a different colour. If you leave the second version alone, it turns back into the first version, which is more stable, but if you have tons of UV around, like you are in the sun, then that bond keeps breaking. The first version keeps turning back into the second version, so it's like a balloon that you keep in the air by tapping it repeatedly. Magnetic polishers contain black iron oxide, and this is ferromagnetic, which means that it gets attracted to a regular magnet. You hover a magnet over the polish before it dries, and the black iron oxide gets attracted to the top, and you see some sort of pattern. If it's formulated correctly, the polish should be thick enough that it dries and it still has that pattern. Black iron oxide is also used in the special eyeliners that you can use with magnetic fake lashes. Glow-in-the-dark pigment is usually zinc sulfide doped with copper, and they're like a special type of absorption pigment. With normal absorption pigments, you have electrons that can absorb light energy. The electrons have extra energy, they are unstable, so they release that energy really quickly, and usually that comes out as heat. That's why black pigments get hotter in the sun than white pigments, because the black pigments are absorbing all of the light and turning it into heat. But glow-in-the-dark pigments are phosphorescent, which means they have two differences. First off, their electrons, after they absorb the light energy, they're pretty stable, they're pretty happy to keep that extra energy for a bit before releasing it slowly. Secondly, their electrons release the energy as light rather than heat. That's why you can charge glow-in-the-dark things by putting them in a bright light. That light gets stored in those electrons and released later. If you enjoyed this video, you might also like this one, which analyzes how much UV you get indoors. You can also check out my myth-busting playlist and my book, The Science of Beauty.